Today we are going to start with chapter 2 of historiography, that is dealing with Indian tradition. In the previous chapter we had seen historiography development in the West. We had seen how historiography writing developed in the European and the American countries and all those things we had seen. Now in this chapter we are going to see that how the writing of critical historical writing, okay, how the writing of critical historical narrative was practiced or developed into the Indian tradition. So let's start. So here when we say tradition of Indian historiography, so let us see the map of India where we have from the northern part till the southern part, okay, that is from Jammu Kashmir till Kanyakumari, okay, that is Tamil Nadu is a state. Then we have from the western part, that is from Gujarat till the eastern part, okay, that is Arunachal Pradesh. So in different parts and provinces, which we call as states and union territories, we'll see how there were different historians and what all teachings or what all contribution they gave towards Indian historiography. So very firstly, in this chapter, when we are going to learn in part 2.1 about the tradition of Indian historiography, we are going to see how historiography developed in ancient Indian history, in medieval Indian history, and thirdly in modern Indian history. Okay, so here we see Indian history is divided into ancient period. So ancient period of Indian history is from the Stone Age period till the 7th century AD. Okay, AD was the olden system, but the new system of timeline is CE, that is Common Era. So here we can see a picture, okay, where in this picture you can see that there are various small pictures which shows you, this shows you a symbol of religion. This both are Harappan inscriptions, okay, or Harappan seals which were found. Then this is one temple, this is the symbol which we see in all our national symbols, okay. Then we can see this is one statue which was excavated in the Harappan civilization. Then this one again is photo of a god. Okay, this is Ashoka wheel which shows that how Indians have struggled for getting progress. Then again this is one sant and various other. Indian history is classified into the ancient period, okay, very old period, then the medieval period which we call in between, and then the modern period. So the ancient period is from the Stone Age till the 7th century. Firstly, we are going to see about the ancient period. Remaining all things will be seen later in the other slides. So here, when we see historiography in the ancient period, so here we see that in the ancient period, whatever activities the ancient people used to do, the great heroes used to do, okay, like for example there were Shivaji Maharaj and many other great leaders. So these all people's activities, whatever great deeds they have done, okay, this all things were orally and verbally spoken by the elderly people, and then it was passed on from one generation to generation, either by speaking or else they had made some songs. Okay, these songs used to describe all the heroic deeds and acts of all the heroes, and in the form of short stories which they used to keep on passing from one generation to other generation in the form of story. They used to tell all these things, okay. So this all deeds of ancestors and mythological lore means all the mythological stories. These all memories of social transition means how from one time to the other time, means from one particular year to the other year. So this all transitions were passed on from one generation to the other generation verbally or orally, okay, that is through oral recitals. Like this, historical events and things were discussed. So here I gave you example like heroic deed of Shivaji Maharaj. These all things were spoken by people and then they used to pass it to the other generation. Okay, so now whatever written documents which we have, which is in the very early form, okay, bahut june samane ka jo bhi un logo ka written documents tha, वो सबका सब होता था इन द फॉर्म ऑफ inscriptions. Okay, now what are inscription? Inscriptions means something which is engraved and written on hard surface, such as rock, or it would be engraved on some stone or on some monuments, or inscriptions are also found on certain metals and plates. Okay, so these all, whatever was the early writing in the olden times, they used to inscribe and keep. So these all are called as inscriptions. Okay, and the script means whatever were the letters that they used, that all were also very of a very ancient origin, which we can't understand now. And till date, Harappan civilization, whatever excavation had taken place and whatever inscriptions they had got on that, whatever script was there, till date it is not yet deciphered, means it is not decoded and obtained in our current language. Okay, till now people are researching on that. So during the ancient period, there was a great king called as Ashoka. He was a king of the Mauryan dynasty. Now any king used to rule for a particular number of years, and they used to have one name. Okay, that certain name was the dynasty by which they were popular. Like King Ashoka belonged to the community of Maurya, and hence he was a king of the Mauryan Empire or Mauryan dynasty. And he was a very popular king, and he was very much ambitious. He wanted to conquer every part of the country, and he had conquered many parts of the country of India in the present scenario. Okay, so what had happened is, when he had captured so many places, but when there was one big war due to which many people were killed, and then there was a lot of blood everywhere, there was a huge bloodshed which he had seen, by that he was deeply affected and moved, and hence he took a pledge that henceforth no fighting, no war, no killing of people, no killing of children, and no killing of innocent people, no bloodshed. And henceforth he accepted Buddhism religion. Okay, because he gave up war completely and he liked the principles of Buddhism religion, he became a Buddhist. And similarly, in his time, whatever were the rules and laws and regulation, those all rules, laws and regulation were not written on any book or paper. Right now what we do, those all were inscribed in such inscriptions, okay, somewhere on the walls, somewhere even on the big stones and all those. And whatever artifacts, okay, even when this Harappan society's excavation was done, so at that time also, whatever artifacts we had got at that time, such as this is an example. So these all artifacts and the other inscriptions tell, and they give us a proof and evidence that Indians had till that time had got a good hold of the art of writing. Okay, this all things we come to know from our Indian historiography. And then we proceed further. So now when we proceed further, historiography in the ancient period, so here again we see that this again is an inscription. Okay, here we see some drawing and some script is written, some letters are written and scribbled, which we are not able to understand at all. So such inscriptions were visible on different types of coins, they were visible on metals. Okay, I was telling about King Ashoka. Okay, so King Ashoka had determined to change. He had decided to change after the war of Kalinga. He had told that he will no longer be known as evil Ashoka, wicked or bad, okay, or that villain Ashoka, but he wants to be known as a good and kind and humble king. And hence he also gave order in his time to many of his servants and people to make such inscriptions. Okay, so art of writing Indians had mastered in the very ancient times. So Ashoka had given orders that on big pillars like this, big constructions, and even on the rocks, okay, rules and regulations be written, engraved, so that it is inscribed and kept, and people will give importance and people will start following that. So whenever we see such ancient inscriptions, okay, so we see inscriptions on some statues or sculptures or idols, Okay, on copper plates they had inscribed some drawings. Okay, then here we see some coins of Tughlaq dynasty. Okay, this was also one king who was reigning in the ancient period, who was ruling. So in his coins also you can see these are certain letters which are inscribed and kept, though we do not understand them. And even on the metals, even on metals there were certain things inscribed and kept. Then we proceed further. This all things had happened in the first century CE. Now again, when we see historiography in the ancient period, so these all things, when we see all these inscriptions, okay, so by all these inscriptions, whatever we see on the coins, okay, just now what we saw on the coins, we saw on the plates, copper plates, on metals, we saw on various sculptures. So by all these things, what we come to know is, we come to know that which particular king was ruling in that particular era, and how big and huge and vast their dynasty was, what all were the policies that they had started for the people, and how was the life of the people over there in that particular kingdom. These all things we come to know by the help of all these inscriptions and the script which is written on them. So here we can see the timeline. Okay, we see genealogy, we see a time, the timeline of history, where we see how during various years there were various kings ruling. So how we come to know about the rule of all these kings? Because of certain proof which we get in the form of inscriptions. On that inscription there are somewhere their names written, some year is written. Okay, because of all these things we come to know that yes, their territories was from Jammu Kashmir till Kanyakumari, or how vast their territory was. Okay, then we also come to know about the climate of that particular place, because there are certain things inscribed on the stone inscriptions. And then we see, we also come to know that which kings were ruling and how they had organized the whole kingdom and the system. So this is the advantage of reading and studying the inscription, so that we get a concrete, or else we get a sure shot and a correct record of history. Then we also get to know about the condition of famine over there. Okay, if people were not having food, famine is such a situation where there is not enough rain. Due to no rain, there are no crops growing, and due to no crops growing well, and also due to absence of water, people do not have to eat. Animals, people, okay, no one has to eat and drink, and hence people are such malnourished and they can easily get affected. Okay, so by the help of all these inscriptions and whatever ancient script we have got, by that we understand that yes, in the ancient period this king was ruling, their dynasty was there, or their territory was from this place to that place, from north to south, west to east, and even about their genealogy, that after one generation which was the next generation of ruler. Then in our ancient period historiography, there were also certain epics. Okay, now very firstly we have got huge literature. Now what is literature? Literature means different types of books written in different languages. When I say different types of book, that can be about any subject. That subject can be about history, Marathi, okay, or it can be about science, maths. So whatever books are written pertaining to different subjects and in different languages, that is called as literature. So in the ancient Indian literature, we have epics. Epics means they are very long, 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 big, big, huge stories. Okay, such as Ramayana and Mahabharata. This all we know because people have watched them on the TV. Okay, so we see there are so many hundreds of episodes for this whole Ramayana and Mahabharata to finish. So these epics such as Ramayana, Mahabharata, then there are many Puranas, okay, many things written in the ancient script by the ancient people, these all things. And even the Vedas such as the Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, Atharva Veda, these all Vedas, okay, whatever things were written in the ancient time, these all give us a glimpse of history. Okay, these all tell us about the ancient heritage of India. Apart from that, there were also many this thing, we also call something as travelogue. Now, what is travelogue? Travelogue is a travel account. Like nowadays in the modern world, we see, okay, there are certain movies in which they show that one person has visited a place and then the whole description about that place is given. Similarly, many people make their vlog on YouTube. They upload videos, okay, where people go to visit one place, and in that particular place, whatever things they have noticed and observed, the climate of that place, then the weather of that place, then the food available, the life of the people, okay, those all things, whatever the person has witnessed during those particular days for which he or she has stayed, they write in travelogue. So travelogue is nothing but a travel account, okay. So those all things give us information about the ancient Indian historiography, and these all are very important sources of history for us, because see, right now we are in the modern world and we are in the present world. We cannot see what happened in the past, okay? So we need to depend on all these sources of history, so that once we read them or once we watch old videos or something, then we get an idea. Oh, life was like this in the ancient time. Oh, they used to do things like this. Oh, people used to wear such clothes, people used to eat such food, and people used to get such kind of education. Okay, then there was a time where people started writing slowly, steadily, as time used to progress, they started writing biography. Now, what is the meaning of autobiography and biography? Okay, like everyone knows, on TV, we have watched Milkha Singh movie. Okay, we have watched Mary Kom movie. So these all are called as biopic. Means that particular character was there in reality, but somebody else has played the character of that particular person, and then the movie is made. That is called as a biopic. So similarly, biography means about any character somebody else has written in greater details, everything right from start to end, okay? So that is called as a biography. An autobiography means if I write about myself, so that is called as an autobiography. So here in this ancient period, there was a phase, there was a time where many people used to write biographies. Okay, means I am a person, like I am getting influenced by our Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So I write about his life. Okay, I write many things, what he does, what all activities he does. So that will be a biography written by me. So here there was a person called as Kalhana. Okay, and this person Kalhana, if you remember, he was a Indian historian. When we had done chapter 1, development, historiography, development in the West, we had seen he is a very famous Indian historian, Kalhana. So Kalhana, he had written, okay, Kalhana had written Raj Tarangini, but before that we have Banabhatta's Harsha Charita. Okay, so there was Banabhatta, also one writer of India, Indian historian, who had written this book called as Harsha Charita. So in that, Harsha is about one king, okay, about one king Harsha, and he had written his whole life story. Charita means whole life story, right from the beginning till the end, whole biography. So in this, when we read this, so here he focused on all the things which were real, okay, which were very practical and logical. Those all things are mentioned in this Harsha Charita. And we also see that when this book was written and when the historians used to write, they used to show, they used to portray, okay, they used to describe real picture, what is actually going on, okay, what is happening in reality in the social life of that person or in that particular year or time, how people used to live in the society, how was their economic life, means how they were managing buying, selling, related to money, how they were managing all their things, and then political. Now when I say political, political means that aspect of life, how they, the people in that particular area were being ruled, who was ruling them and how they were ruled. And religious, when I say about religious concepts, so they were following which god, okay, which religion they were following. And when I say cultural life, so cultural life of people means which has got everything to do with culture. What all food they eat, the clothes they wear, this depends upon the culture. What all festivals they celebrate, okay, how they live their daily life. So this all comes in the cultural aspect. So when we see the biography written Harshacharita by Banabhatta, so in that all realistic features are depicted, which will be regarding the social, political, religious, cultural and economic things related to that particular ancient time. Those all things are mentioned. Okay, so these all are real things. Then we are going to proceed further. Okay, now we are going to see the historiography in the medieval period. So till now we saw about the ancient period. We saw that how King Ashoka, okay, had ordered many inscriptions to be made on rocks and even on huge pillars. Then we had seen that how people started, learnt the art of writing. Okay, though their script is not yet deciphered, but they had started the art of writing from third millennium. Now, when I say millennium, millennium is a period of 1000 years. So third millennium is 3000. Okay, BCE, before the birth of Jesus Christ, before common era, okay, in the ancient period. Then the art of writing was developed by people. Then people started writing. Whatever were their written records, they were available in the form of edicts, okay, on stones, rocks, pillars and all those things. Then we had also seen that inscriptions started coming on metal coins. Then we had seen on idols, on rocks and even on copper plates. Okay, so this all give us the information about the life of the people, and this inscriptions tell us about the rule of the king, the dynasty, the genealogy, which territories they were ruling on, okay, and how much successful they were, how was the climate at that time, and how the weather conditions were also there, and how the people's social life was there. Then we also saw about Harshacharit, which was written by Banabhatta, where he has given a real record based on the social, political, economic and cultural and religious life of the people. Now we are going to start, we are going to take one step further, that is from ancient, we are taking another ladder or step, that is towards the medieval period. So Indian history, medieval period is from 8th to 18th century. This is CE. Okay, CE means common era. Okay, AD. So in the medieval period, they have again classified in the textbook. They have not mentioned, but here we can just go through it. In the early medieval, it is from 8th century to 13th century. The late medieval period is from 13th to 18th century. And then we see different kingdoms. Okay, there were Rajput, Palas, Pratiharas, Chalukyas, Rashtrakutas, Delhi Sultanate. So now in our chapter, we are going to focus about the Mughal rule, okay, Delhi Sultanate rule. Then we will see how various travelers had come to Vijayanagar kingdom and which all books they wrote. Okay, so like this, we are going to see now in this medieval period section. So now when we proceed further, Kalhana is a very popular Indian historian, so he had written Rajatarangini. Okay, so here what is the meaning of this Rajatarangini? A chronicle of the kings of Kashmir. So in Kashmir, whichever kings were ruling in whichever particular time, he has written everything in correct chronological order. And how he could write everything in correct chronological order? Because anything he would get, any source of history he would get, he would examine it, he would cross check, he would verify it. Remember in René Descartes, he told, okay, we have to verify and critically examine all the documents and sources of history. Same thing Kalahana also was doing. Whatever inscriptions he got, coins, monuments, okay, monuments are huge popular buildings, okay, dynastic records. Any dynasty means what? Reign or rule of a king or kingdom rule. So when that kingdom rule is going on, so at that time whatever manuscripts were written, okay, those all records, and whatever was the local traditions of the people, means people who were living in that particular area, in that particular kingdom, what they used to do locally. Like for example, if a person is a localite of Mumbai, okay, we call that person as a Mumbaikar. So in the local tradition, we know in Mumbai, vada pav is very popular. In Mumbai, festivals like Diwali, Holi, okay, and even this one, okay, Dashera is very popular because there people play and sing and dance to the tune of music. So this is an example of local tradition. So these all things Kalahana wrote, but what important thing he did was, or what excellent thing he did was, he examined everything. Okay, so in historiography, what we are learning is whatever records are there, those all are verified, cross-checked, examined well, and then records are made, or then things are written. Okay, this was about, we had seen about Rajatarangini. Okay, so Rajatarangini was written in 12th century CE, because we are learning the history of medieval period, which is from 8th century to 18th century. So in that 8th to 18th century, we get 12th century CE. Okay, so we saw how Kalahana had written by examining everything critically, properly. Okay, now we are going to proceed further. So in the medieval period, there was rule of Mughals. So when there were Mughal rules, there were Muslim rulers. So in those Muslim rulers' courts, there were various historians. So one such historian is Ziauddin Barani. Okay, this is Ziauddin Barani, and he had written a book, and that book is called as Tariq-e-Firuzshahi. Okay, now what is there in this Tariq-e-Firuzshahi? He has written everything. That is, he has written all the purpose of historiography, that what is the benefit or what is the target, what is the objective of historiography, that was written by Ziauddin Barani in this book, Tariq-e-Firuzshahi. Okay, so what he tells is, he tells very practically and very logically. Okay, we all are human beings, we all make mistakes, we all never do correct things, we do wrong things also sometimes. Okay, so what Firuzshahi was telling, that whenever people are writing history, they should write about the king's valor, okay, that is bravery, what all brave deeds or courageous deeds the king has done, whatever policies or whatever new schemes are introduced by the king for the welfare of the people of the kingdom. But along with these good things, historians should also include the negative things. Okay, it is not necessary if the king has launched some scheme. Okay, so it is not necessary that 100% that scheme will be successful or it will be excellent. There may be some loopholes, there may be some negativity or some problems in that, or there are chances that scheme may fail. So what Ziauddin Barani says, that in historiography, people should maintain, write all the positive aspects and even the negative aspects. Even if the king has failed, okay, even if the king has lost any war, or if the king's policies have not got that successful, okay, those all things should be mentioned when people are writing any historical record. Okay, this was told about this person, Ziauddin Barani. So after this, the scope, okay, means earlier people used to see only a limited nutshell, that in this limited nutshell, whatever king is doing good, king is helping people, king is helping farmers, okay, king is taking good care of the people, and king is giving help to the needy people, oh, this is only good. But it is not the only thing which king does. King sometimes launches some new idea or scheme, and sometimes it may be a flop, but those also should be mentioned. The failures also should be mentioned in the records of history. This was mentioned by Ziauddin Barani, and hence the scope of history expanded, or this nutshell grew, that include positive aspects and even the negative aspects in historical records. Now we proceed further. Now we proceed further with more historians who were there in the Mughal emperor's courts. Okay. So just as what we saw in the previous discussion, we discussed that in the medieval period, Ziauddin Barani was a historian who told that whenever people are writing historiography, they should mention ruler's valor. Valor is bravery, courage, bahaduri. Okay, ruler's welfare policies, usne logo ke liye naya naya scheme kya launch kiya, jo bhalai ke liye tha wo. teachings of the wise also should be included. Okay, in that kingdom or amongst around the king, whoever is giving good advice to the king, okay, whatever good teachings are given by the wise people, people have got a lot of wisdom, jinke paas bahut zyada buddhi experience, those things should be included in historiography. Teachings of the learned people, people those who have learnt a lot, they know more, okay, those people's inputs also should be taken in historiography. Also rulers' failures, if at all by chance ruler had thought everything to work well, positive only for people, but by chance something did not work well, okay, the ruler got failed somewhere, that should be mentioned. And even rulers' incorrect policies, okay, as we all know, we all are human beings, okay, we all may take incorrect decision or may choose something incorrectly, so those all things should be mentioned in historiography. This was the new what we can say, this was the new norm or the new idea given by Ziauddin Barani. Then we'll also see what various historians were telling in the Mughal court. Now here we see this picture shows us, this is a Mughal court, okay, and in this Mughal court this is the emperor, and here we see a person, okay, who is a courtier. So these people used to do everything to impress and to keep their emperors or kings happy, okay, they used to do all the tasks very nicely, they used to praise the emperor so that it will be visible that, oh, this courtier or this servant of mine is so loyal to me, okay, kitne wafadar hai, kitne acche, hamesha mera acha bolte hai, hamesha mujhse acche se baat karte hai, like that. No doubt, if a person is doing good, praise. But by chance, if the person has done something wrong, that should not be praised. Okay, wrong has to be stopped then and there only. So in the olden times, in the Mughal period, there used to be certain people who used to always praise the rulers, okay, to become more loyal to them, like that. And then slowly and steadily, during this Mughal period, there were two more new fashions. Like we know in our modern trendy society, day by day, okay, I'll talk about a smartphone. The smartphone is now, but earlier it was not even a mobile phone. It was just a landline, and then slowly, slowly it became a very heavy mobile phone. Then slowly the size and the weight of that phone decreased. And then we started getting that flap piece mobile. Then we started getting color mobile. Then slowly, steadily, smartphone, touch screen, and all those things have come up. Okay, so similarly, how this slow and steady progress has taken place, fashion has changed. Similarly, in the Mughal ruler's time also, in historiography writing, there was a change in fashion. Okay, no doubt, people were writing all real things, people were writing everything by critically examining and verifying the records and documents, but they inserted two new things, that was inserting beautiful pictures, and they were writing good poetic quotes, okay, in the historiography records. This was new, which started in the medieval period. Okay, beautiful poetries are written, some lines in Arabic, Urdu, which we don't understand. I don't understand, okay, especially. And this is beautiful pictures also, they started putting in the records of history. And these all things, whatever was real pertaining to that particular era, that only they were putting. And then we are also going to see about various other historians, okay, various other travelers who had come to India for a certain period, but during that certain period, what all important contribution they did in the Indian historiography. Like this person whom we see, he is Al-Biruni, okay, he is Al-Biruni, and this person Al-Biruni, he has written in Arabic language, he has written about Indian knowledge, when he had come to India, whatever things he got to learn from India, that, and he has also written about the social life of people in India in his book. And these all things, whatever he has written, that is all after examining the records properly, or whatever he observed, whatever was the real picture, real life scenario going on, those all things he has mentioned. Okay, apart from Al-Biruni, we also have other people. Okay, like Ibn Battuta is there, then Marco Polo is there. There are many, many more people in the list. Now this person is Hasan Nizami. Okay, this Hasan Nizami, he was a Persian language poet and historian. He lived in this 12th and 13th centuries, means this is exactly the medieval period of Indian history, from 8th century to 18th century. So 12th and 13th century come in that period, and he wrote Tajul Masar. Okay, now in this Tajul Masar, he has written in Persian, but whatever things he has written about the observations he did in India, those all things show that he had got a very good command over Arabic language, means his Arabic language was very good. Okay, he has written it very nicely, and he has also written all correct records. Okay, then we have another person. Okay, now this another person, his name is Minhaj-e-Siraj. He is Minhaj-e-Siraj, and he has written Tabaqat-e-Nasiri. This is also one historical record which he has written. Okay, in this also he has used all the historiography tactics. That tactic is writing everything after verifying and critically examining. Then we have another person. Okay, this person's name is Abul Hasan, and he is also called as Amir Khusrau. He was a Sufi singer, poet, and a scholar from India. So he has also written various books, okay, during that medieval period. Then there are various people in the list, such as Tuzuki Timuri. Okay, Tuzuki Timuri has written the autobiography of Timur. Okay, now the autobiography of Timur, Tuzuki Timuri, was written by Timuri Lang. Okay, now this Timuri Lang was also called as Amir Timur, and this person had invaded India. These all people had come to rule over India, to capture India. So when he was here, he has also written about his own life. Okay, the autobiography of Timur is written by this person, Amir Timur. Okay, then we proceed further with other historians in the list. There are many such people. Then this person is Yahya bin Ahmad Sirhindi. Okay, Yahya Sirhindi, if you remember, that is also enough. Again, 15th century. 15th century comes in from 8th century to 18th century medieval period. He has written Tariq-e-Mubarak Shahi. Okay, he has written it in Persian language. And when he was over here, when the Delhi Sultanate, okay, when there was Sultan's rule in the province of Delhi in India, at that time he was over there. And then he has written it during the reign of Mubarak Shah, when Mubarak Shah was the king who was ruling at that time, how he ruled the whole kingdom, what all things were there, those all things he has mentioned. Okay, and then why he has written this, see, now here we can see. Yahya expected to become a courtier of Mubarak Shah, okay, a ruler of Delhi Sultanate. Hence, he wrote Tariq-e-Mubarak Shahi and presented it to Sultan that he will win the royal patronage, okay. So, out of all this, there are some people who have written genuinely, and there are some people who have only mentioned the positive things. They have not mentioned the negative things. Now, in this case, Yahya bin Ahmad Sirhindi, okay, he has written everything just to impress, okay, and to get the post of courtier in the Delhi Sultanate. So these people are different. There are different historians who have given different contribution. But what we are learning from all these things is that we have to include both positive and negative aspects. Okay, our perspective should not be partial. Our perspective should not be biased, okay, which will take the side of one person. No, we have to be neutral. We have to go with the correct. Neither go towards the positive aspects nor the negative. Whatever is correct, take its side. Okay, then we have other historian called as Ibn Battuta. Okay, now this Ibn Battuta was a Moroccan scholar and explorer who had traveled traveled the whole world during the medieval period. So he had come into India when it was the medieval period of Indian history. So in the period of total 30 years, Ibn Battuta has visited many Islamic world and non-Muslim lands. He had come to Asia. So when we say Asia, at that time he had visited India and China also. Okay, so Ibn Battuta also has mentioned many things in his historical records, whatever things he had seen in India. Then there was another person called as Abdul Razak. Okay, he was the ambassador of Shah Rukh Khan, Shah Rukh, the Timurid dynasty. So here again, when Timur dynasty was there, okay, of Persia to Calicut. So they were ruling. Persia is present day Iran. Okay, so from January 1442, this is again the medieval period. Here we have to just remember the names of the historian and what book they wrote. That much is enough. So here he has written a 45-page narrative when he was there in India. So in this whole journey, what all things he experienced, he saw, he observed, those all records are maintained by Abdul Razak in now this Abdul Razak has written, but which book he has written, they have not mentioned. They have just mentioned the narrative he has written. That's it, one narrative. We can find it on Google. Okay, then they have given about Marco Polo. Now Marco Polo was a Venetian merchant. Now when I say Venetian, means he was from the country of Venice. Okay, he was an explorer. The explorer means these people, they just explore, they go to different parts of the world, okay, just to find out new places, because right now in the modern world we have all this railways, airways, all the ways, land, means of transport established, developed, all cities are found, but at that time cities were not explored. So this person was an explorer, he was a writer also, who traveled through Asia, okay, along the Silk Road. Now when I say Silk Road, means this were the areas where silk was available in great quantity, and this is called Silk Road because lot of silk was traded and money was made through this particular areas where he traveled in the southern part. Okay, so this again, if you see the year 1271 to 1295, so this is again the medieval period between 8th to 18th century CE. Then we have another person, Niccolo G. Conti. Okay, he was an Italian merchant. He was also an explorer and writer, and he had come to India, and he had also gone to southern China during the 15th century. These all people, when they visited, they had ample of time with them. Okay, right now in the modern scenario, we have WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram. At that time, there were all these things were not available. So what they used to do, whatever they used to see around them, they used to start recording. They used to write and keep them. And thank God they have written so that we can examine them and get what was the reality at that time. Then they have given about another person called as Barbosa, Duarte Barbosa. He was a Portuguese writer, and he also had written a book. Okay. So whatever was his travel experience, he has mentioned that. So these all are example of different travelers who had come to India and they wrote travelogues. Okay, this all are examples of travelogues. Domingo Pais, he was also a Portuguese traveler, and he was of the Vijayanagar Empire. If you remember, we had studied in the early medieval period, there was Vijayanagar dynasty, Vijayanagar kingdom. So in that empire, he had visited, Domingo Pais had visited. So he had written one record. Okay, historiography record was maintained by him. Then we proceed further with historiography in the medieval period. We have great Mughal emperors. Okay, so this is the timeline where we have Babur, and after Babur, the next successor, son of Babur, was Humayun. Okay, in olden times this used to happen, whoever was the king's son will take the throne. Again, that king's son will take the throne. Like this, the kingdom used to go on and on. So your Babur's son was Humayun, Humayun's son was Akbar, Akbar's son was Jahangir, then we had Shah Jahan, and ultimately we had this Aurangzeb. Okay, if you remember your lower standard history, Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj and this Aurangzeb, they used to always be in a cross. There was enmity because this Mughals had come to capture India and Maharashtra, and Shivaji Maharaj did not want to give Maharashtra into the hands of these Mughal leaders. Okay, so now when we see about the great Mughal emperor, this Mughal dynasty was started by Babur. So we are going to see that in the reign of Babur also there was a book written. Okay, so here what was written is Babur, who was the founder of Mughal Empire, because we see when Mughal Empire we saw six generations, so we saw the first one was Babur. So he has written Tuzuk-e-Babri. Okay, now this Tuzuk-e-Babri is also called as Babur Nama. In that, what he has written, okay, that is his own autobiography, his own life story written by himself. So in that, many things he has described, whatever battles he fought, okay, whether the battles he won or he lost, okay, kaun kaun sa yudh ladai mein inhone participate kiya tha, wo jeete ki wo hare, और कौन कौन से एरियाज में वो गए थे, कौन कौन से एरिया में वो रहे थे, उन्होंने क्या वहाँ पर देखा, उनका सोशल लाइफ क्या था, ओके, हाउ वर द कस्टम्स ऑफ द पीपल ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर एरिया, वहाँ के लोगों का रीति रिवाज, उठना बैठना, खाना पीना, वो सब क्या था, कैसा होता था, दैट ऑल ऑल्सो ही हैज मैंशनड इन द बुक कॉल्ड टुज़ुके बाबरी. सो योर वॉट वी ही इज ट्राइंग वी आर ट्राइंग टू गेटिंग टू नो इज दैट ही ऑल्सो रोट actual records, real records, okay. Then, now Babur was a very educated person, okay. So whatever things he has written it accurate, he has written it after verifying it, cross-checking it and critically examining it, understanding. He wrote about various things. He, in his book, this all is extra info. He has covered various topics such as astronomy. He was an educated person. He knew many things about astronomy, geography, statecraft, military matters. Many things he has mentioned in that Tuzuke Babri. Okay, now we proceed further. So now we proceed further with Abul Fazl Akbarnama. Okay, one more thing. When we go see this Tuzuke Babri, so this in this Tuzuke Babri, Babur has also mentioned about the flora and fauna which was visible in his area. When we say flora and fauna, they are plants and animals. Okay, flora, you can remember shortcut as flower, we call as. So flora means we are talking about the natural vegetation and plantation of any particular area. And when we say fauna, so we are talking about all kinds of animals and birds available in that particular area. So in this Tuzuke Babri, Babur has mentioned about all the battles which he had fought. After battle, he has mentioned about the cities and regions which he visited, and he has also mentioned about the local economy, customs and the flora, whatever was present over there or whatever he had seen. Then we proceed further with Abul Fazl. Okay, now there was another person called as Abul Fazl. Now who is this Abul Fazl? This Abul Fazl was one of the nine jewels in Akbar's court. Okay, now when we see the Mughal rule, so we had seen Babur, then Humayun, then Akbar. Okay, so this Akbar was a very popular king. Okay, very popular Mughal ruler who had done many good, great things in India for the people of India when he was ruling India. And in his court, he had got nine jewels, mean nine excellent and extraordinary people in different fields. One extraordinary singer, one extraordinary person who was very brainy, that was Birbal. Akbar Birbal stories are very famous. So in that, there was an excellent writer and poet, that was Abul Fazl. And this Abul Fazl wrote Akbar Nama. Okay, so now in this Akbar Nama, what he has written is, in Akbar Nama, he has written all critical historiography, means whatever records he has written, he has critically examined it, verified it, checked it, and then he has written. And whatever method he has used, that is, he has used collecting historical document, and that was authentic. Authentic means actual or real or genuine. Okay, like when we go, when we get some gold, okay, we may think it is gold, but we go and show it to the goldsmith and then he does something to check the authenticity, okay, the purity or the genuinity of that particular gold. So he, Abul Fazl is very popular and we are reading about him because he has written historical, authentic historical documents, okay, all real, genuine and good ones, accurate ones, correct ones, and they are scrutiny. Okay, he has even checked it well, and in that there is no biasness, there is no partiality. Okay, he has written it in a very logical, rational way, neutral way, without taking anybody's side. Okay, so therefore, two important keywords from Abul Fazl Akbar Nama is he has written authentic historical documents. And he has scrutinized it without any bias, without any partiality. Okay. Then we proceed further with historiography in the medieval period. So there was one more type of historical record, which is called as Bakhar. Okay, so Bakhar is a form of historical narrative. It is all written in Marathi prose. Prose means there are paragraphs written, okay, like in languages you have prose and poetry. So this is not in the form of poetry, not stanzas, but there are paragraphs, okay. So yeah, in Bakhar, what do we have? We have eulogies of the heroic deeds, okay, of the heroes and stories of historic events, battles, lives of great men. So in Bakhar, what we have? Great deeds, great activities, whatever things were done by the heroes, whoever were present in Maharashtra in a particular, in that medieval period. So about them, whatever achievements were done, whatever great things were done. Okay, so those all things are mentioned, eulogies are mentioned in Bakhar. Okay, so 17th to 19th century. So here we see medieval period is from 8th to 18th, but 18th, 17th to 19th. So 19, though it crosses 18, but still it is somewhere in the medieval period only. So all the activities, great deeds, great wars which they have won, okay, that all is mentioned. So here there are different Bakhar which is mentioned. Bhau Sahibanchi Bakhar, Panipatachi Bakhar, Sabhasad Bakhar, Holkaranchi Kefir. These all names are written here in English in the textbook. Okay, so now when I say this Bhau Sahibanchi Bakhar, so in this Bhau Sahibanchi Bakhar, they have mentioned about the Battle of Panipat. So Battle of Panipat, there were first, third, second and third, three battles which took place at Panipat. That was between the Maratha on one side and the Afghan people on the other side, okay, Afghan rulers. So that all great deeds, heroic deeds of all Maratha warriors and soldiers are mentioned in that Bhau Sahibanchi Bakhar. Then we have Sabhasad Bakhar. Now when I say Sabhasad Bakhar, so this Sabhasad Bakhar is written by Krishnaji, okay, Krishnaji Anand Sabhasad. So in this Sabhasad Bakhar, what is mentioned is, it was written in the reign of Shivaji, Chhatrapati Rajaram Maharaj. Now who is Chhatrapati Rajaram Maharaj? When we see this Chhatrapati, it is a title given to all family, all male family members of Shivaji Maharaj. We know Chhatrapati was a title given by people. So whatever great deeds were done by Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, about his great deeds was written by Krishnaji Anand Sabhasad in the Sabhasad Bakhar, and this was written when there was rule of Chhatrapati Rajaram Maharaj, okay, during his rule. Then we have about Holkaranchi Kaifiyat. Now in Holkaranchi Kaifiyat, they have written about Holkar. Holkar was also one group who was very brave in very much ambitious and heroic in all their activities when they used to fight against the British. Okay, but there is one mention where they could not withstand the British and they had to leave the battlefield and run away. Okay, then we proceed further with historiography in the medieval period. So in this Bakhar, what all things are there? We find kings, biographies about kings. Somebody else has written dynastic history, Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, and below him there was Sambhaji, Raja Ram, like this, how the rule goes on. Descriptions of events, okay, in each and every war or activity, what all things had happened, that is described. History of a sect. Now what is a sect? One particular group is called as sect. Like for example, in Hindus we have Brahmins, Vaishya, Shudras, okay, Kshatriya. So Brahmin is one sect, one group. Similarly, Kshatriya, Shudra, Vaishya, this is one sect. Autobiography means about my life story, I am only writing, that is autobiography. Then mythologies, okay, mythology is all about the stories of gods and goddesses. These all are mentioned in Bakhar. Now we proceed, now we have come towards the end of this part, that is first part, Indian tradition of Indian historiography. So here we are going to see about the modern period historiography. So modern period of historiography starts from 18th century onwards. Okay, so here we are 18th century onwards. So till date, whatever we are in, that is modern history only. Okay, right now we are in the present era. After 10-20 years, when other people will look at 20 years, so that will be a history for them. So here in the 20th century, there were many explorers and archaeological excavations they were doing, and these people, many British had come to India and they were digging the ground and trying to find out various things. So many archaeological exploration took place. So there was one person called as Sir Alexander Cunningham. Okay, he was the first director of archaeological survey of India, because he was the one who started this. Okay, he was the one who started this, and then he helped further in carrying out various archaeological excavation. Okay, then we also see that Harappan civilization excavation took place in this particular modern period only by in the modern period there were also people like Sir John Marshall whose time this Harappan civilization excavation had started. And how he got information about this Harappan civilization? When he read some Buddhist texts. What are Buddhist texts? Some written records which were written by Buddhist people. Now he came to India, but then how did he get these Buddhist texts? These people were very educated. Okay, this British, they were very much educated. So they just came, they would have happened to read the book, or they would have got to know from somewhere about this Buddhist text. They just started reading and then they came to know about certain sites. They conducted archaeological excavation and they discovered this whole of Harappan civilization. And then when they discovered, they got things which were as old as 3000 millennium BCE or earlier. When I say millennium, it is 1000 years. So third millennium is 3000 BCE or earlier, before the birth of Jesus Christ. Okay, the ancient period. Then we proceed further. We see that there were many British, okay, who were ruling India when there were Mughal rule and other rulers also ruling India. Now we also see that when these British officials were there, they have also written some books about Indian history. When they were ruling over India, at that time they have written some books about Indian history when they were there in India. So amongst these British officials, we have one example of James Mill. Okay, James Mill is this person. He is a British historian who had come to India in the year 1817, and he wrote this, The History of British India. He wrote this book in three volumes, means three parts. Okay, and then in this book, when we verify it, there was absence of objective perspective. Means what? The objective of historiography is you have to write correct records, you have to write real life, you have to write true records. Okay, but these all things were not focused on James Mill's writings, means which shows he did not do justice while writing Indian historiography. And he had got prejudice about Indian culture. Prejudice is you have some pre-notion thinking about someone else. Okay, like many children think history is very boring. So just before reading, just before opening the book, just before learning only, there is always this thought in mind, history is boring. Then it will always be boring. As much ever the teacher tries to make it interesting, it won't be that. So we should not have prejudice, previous thinking we should not have. We should be absolutely neutral. We'll see by reading and by watching, observing, by getting information, we'll think, we'll decide whether it is good or not. So in his records, he has not picturized the real picture or authentic picture. Then we have another person. Okay, he is called as Mountstuart Elphinstone. Now this Mountstuart Elphinstone, when he was ruling in India, he was the governor of Bombay. Bombay was the name given earlier. Currently we call it Mumbai. So in the year 1841, he published a book called The History of India. And in this book also, what we see is he did not write it properly. He did not picture exact reality in that book. Then we have other people called as, this person is Grant Duff. He has written about Maratha history. Okay, he was there in India when Shivaji Maharaj and all his people were ruling. So James Grant Duff, A History of the Marathas. This also he had written in around 2-3 volumes. In that also, he condemned means he criticized, or he insulted, he told negative things about Indian culture and history. See, we have to respect every other human being, every other culture. We can't tell negative things or wrong things about anybody's culture, because that is their own personal thing. We can't interfere personally. So Grant Duff has mentioned many things which was not correct, which was having a lot of bias. And then we have one more person called as James Todd. He has written about the historiography of Rajasthan. In that also, he has not done justice. He has not picturized the real picture. Only we have one person at the end, that is William Wilson Hunter. Okay, this person, William Wilson Hunter, He wrote this book, Imperial Gazetteer of India. He has written without any partiality, without any biasness. So he has written on Indian history, which shows impartial treatment of the subject. So he has written it very much realistically, logically, and after proper verification and examination. Okay. Then there were other two people, Neelkanth Janardhan Kirtani. I could not find his image on Google. And this person is Vishwanath Tashinath Rajwade. Okay, his Rajwade. His picture is given in the textbook also. They both together exposed, means brought in front of everyone, the limitations of Grandaf's writings. Okay, they showed or they declared in front of everyone that whatever Grandaf has written, it's not real history. There is some biasness in that. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Kindly subscribe Shruti's online school for more such videos. And you can ask your doubts by putting them in the comment section. Thank you.